Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. This is a Let's Play where you can decide at the end what our next move is to be. The last two episodes we've been doing directionals. So I'm going to try, we'll see, if we can make it more of a moral choice or a choice of through dialogue or something like that. But the majority of you voted for East. Actually had a new voter last episode. Very happy about that. The more votes, the better, guys. You head out across the steps. The sun is now in the lowest quarter of the sky. The featureless landscape offers little to attract your interest, but in the far distance you can make out the edge of a great forest. With luck, you will reach its shelter before nightfall. A chill wind sweeps across your path, making you shiver. Pull my cloak tighter. You pull your cloak tighter around your body and keep walking. A short while later, another gust of wind hits you with a sudden force, almost knocking you down. Really? Look at the skies. Overhead, dark clouds are gathering, and a rumbling noise rolls across the sky. But east and west, the sky is clear. It seems you are the center of this storm. Well, I would have made this the choice for last time, but I didn't know. Keep going or find shelter? That's a good question. I am the center of the storm. Is it going to follow me into shelter? Let's try to find shelter. If there is a storm coming, it would be wise to find some kind of shelter before it breaks. As the rumbling grows in the air around you, you spy a suitable crevice in the rock. Oh yeah, I want to find out what this is. Head for cover. You pelt for the rocky overhang and squeeze inside, drawing up your cloak as cover. But though the skies darken, no rain falls. Instead, the wind picks up, changing into a swirling gale, as though trying to scoop you from your hiding spot. Should I pray to Korga? I don't like praying to Korga, because every time we do that, we can't pray for a while, I think, right? Grab my belongings. Or hunker down. Pray for aid. You close your eyes and raise a prayer to your graceful God. There is no delay. You feel Korga's healing grace all around you, keeping you safe and protected. Rocks and stones fly about, but none strike you. Let's wait it out. There is nothing else to be done. You sit shivering and wait until the storm passes. When it finally does, the silence rings in your ears, almost as deafening. But wait, I can hear like cicadas or something. You get back to your feet. The steps are smooth and featureless once more, swept clean. You start walking once more. Then the toe of your boot catches something on the ground. Gotta look at it. You look down to see a long, deep scratch in the smooth rock of the step. It runs northeast to southwest for about four strides, and near one end you see another scratch leading away, along at a slant to the first. It runs northeast to southwest. Well, that tower, whatever the hell that is northeast to us. Follow the scratches. You trace the scratches further, finding they make a V shape. Across the middle, a third horizontal scratch joins the two. The symbols were definitely not here before. The rock is scorched here, where it has been struck by lightning, perhaps? Okay, so we got a V shape with a third joining the two. It's an arrow. Oh well, technically it's a triangle. Keep looking. Why is keep looking further away than leave this place? I don't want to leave this place, so I want to see what that is. Can we not get down from there? Maybe we have to go follow the path with his, well, that's gonna be We can't get there from here. This doesn't seem like... Keep looking? Oh, keep looking. You cannot stop now. You pace around the rock until you find another stroke in the dust. To the left of the V, a single vertical bar. Right, part of the arrow, right? To the left. Look further left. Stepping left, you find another vertical scratch. Up until now, you could still almost believe they were fissures in the rock caused by cracking ice, but what you find next dispels that notion. Beside the vertical slash is a short diagonal, and above it, a sweeping semicircular curve. The arc is too perfect, too carefully drawn to be natural. It has been scratched deep into the stone by a powerful claw. Step back. Look around more? You search the flat expanse of stone, but find nothing more. Whatever carved this strange pattern left no more clues. Could it really have been the storm? No, it's a claw. Step back, I guess. I don't know. You step back from the three carved symbols, but cannot make sense of them. On the far left is the vertical stroke, with the semicircle on its lower left and diagonal arm going up and left above. The V on the far is on the far right, and straight stroke is in the middle. On the far left is a vertical semicircle on its lower left. I'm trying to picture this. And diagonal arm going up and left above. I don't know, step around the carving? I thought it was an arrow, but I don't know what's going on with this diagonal arm and the semicircle. Semicircle, yeah. Step around the carving? Oh. You step around the carving to the other side and regard it from the other direction. Suddenly the scratches resolve into meaning. They are letters, and you are looking at them from the wrong side, and they spell out a three-letter word, air. Was this message left by the storm that crossed the rock? Is it a spell? Nothing left but to move on. There is nothing more to be discovered here. You raise your eyes once more to the steps and your journey. Well, now, I want to check this out, because we're near it. You march onwards, ascending and descending as the ground breaks and changes level. Night falls. You need to rest, especially after walking all day without eating. In the darkness, you all but walk into a large pole that is stuck into the ground here. Okay, I thought it was a little tower or something with a flag on top. But it's a large pole. I can rest here. Okay. You settle down with your back to the pole. It is hardly a comfortable place. You are unsheltered and exposed on all sides, but it is late, and if you walk all night, you risk exhausting yourself. You have eaten nothing today. Well, we have one ration. Let's eat something. I feel good that at least we have a blimberry potion. Cool. We're almost maxed out with health here. You eat the forest berries and feel much better for it. Then you lie back and try to forget your troubles. You toss and turn fitfully, your head on your backpack. You dream of a terrible smell and the grunting of some kind of wild dog nearby. Might be real, so let's open my eyes. Oh! Then you open your eyes just in time to see a spiked wooden club raised above your face. This is arbitrary. Roll left or roll right? I'm unsheltered on all sides, my back to the pole. So roll right. You roll right, crashing into a shadowy figure, who groans and stumbles backwards. You jump to your feet. Three tall creatures with powerful arms and ugly faces surround you. Ew. I've walked right into hills without eyes, guys. Or the hills with eyes, right? Look closer. The figures are dressed in animal skins and carry makeshift clubs as weapons. One has an amulet around his neck, dark clay, but the jewel at the center glows with a faint gold-colored sheen. They glare back at you, clearly at least somewhat intelligent, but saying nothing. So they decide to stop hitting me, at least for now? Do they have my stolen amulet? Oh, I have a sun jewel. I'm not sure if that's on a chain like an amulet, but it could be. I used to have two sun jewels, guys, and it was stolen last episode, I believe, by this boy. Or was it a gnome? It was a gnome? I don't even know. Greet them? Try diplomacy with stupid things? Greetings, you begin. I will kill you if you try to harm me. Okay, so much for diplomacy. But the figures merely grunt and groan in reply. You cannot communicate with them if the noises are even a language. Offer them a gift? What would I give them? Do I want to give them things? Is it going to just... If I don't choose, guys, what to give them, and it gives them something that I really... Most of the stuff... Yeah, it's, I don't know if it's randomly going to arbitrarily choose for me what to give them. They're going to have my dice. I need the oil. I would rather... They can have note. Definitely don't want to be giving them any of this stuff. Not even the pebbles. We can use that for the exploding pebbles, whatever spell. Giant's tooth, sun jewel. No, that's mine. Because if it I'm going to try this. If it arbitrarily chooses something, then hopefully we get a choice of something after this. You open your pack. Perhaps they would understand a gift. Everything is too valuable. I will give them a gold piece, though. You toss a gold piece toward them, but they are unmoved and advance closer, thumping their clubs against their open palms. Is it worth trying something else? I like that the game knows that everything is too valuable. I wonder if there would have been something else, you know, that I would have been carrying that maybe I haven't found that would be suitable for them, but not too valuable. But everything you own is too valuable. You shut the pack once more. Cast a spell. They are not that intelligent, we see, so, law. We don't have it. God. Law is charm animal and like, unintelligent things. I don't have it. We got jig, which is uncontrollable dancing. We have YA yap, which is... What's yap again? Talk to things. I think it's something that we don't speak with animal. We don't have the wig for that anyway. And I don't think they're animals. They could be. There was another Y thing, wasn't there? Y-O... Yob? What's Yob? Summon giant, yeah. I kind of want to hold that in... I only have one giant's tooth left. I kind of want to hold on to that. G... Gak? Fear? We need a black face mask for that. God? Charm. Lesser charm? He has the amulet, doesn't he? That requires a jewel of gold? Unless... I don't think that's the same as a sun jewel. Wait. Sun jewel is for light. This says jewel of gold, not sun jewel, so... I don't think I have the... If I might be able to take that from him. Kid? Kid or kin? Kid or kin? Kin is duplicate enemy. I need a gold back mirror for that. And kid? Enhanced illusion. We need a bone bracelet. Bracelet of bone. Don't have that either. We don't have a lot of options here. That's lightning. Zob? The hell is Zob? I don't think I've ever used Zob. Zob. I don't have a Zob. I have a Zip and a Zed, and that's about it. What the hell is Zob? Can I... What is God? Jewel of Gold. Kin in the gold back mirror. Here's our new spell that requires a serpent ring. Spell enables the caster to force information from serpents. That's new. You know, I can back out of that. Let me just see what that does. Is it some new spell that we forgot to... I forgot to add? Unknown. You know, I'm gonna add it to the end here. Why do we even have that option? I don't think I've ever... Zob. Question marks. I'm tempted to cast it just to see what it does, but... It might require something, it might be something we don't want to do. What did I figure was a good one? Uncontrollable dancing? Jig, right? Requires a bamboo flute. I don't think we have that. You really need a lot of items. I think at one point we might have had a bamboo flute. Sorry guys, this is taking so long. Most of the spells, they are... Most of the spells that they're featuring here... require some kind of item, and I don't have any of them. And what's funny is that we can cast Lightning Bolt, but not Fireball. Boom. You cast the enchantment, building up a charge of electrical energy around your palm, pointing at the first of the Klattamen. That's where they are. He explodes in a flash of light. The second leaps on you without delay. The next Klattamen stomps forward, dragging his club behind him in the dust. So I guess I gotta fight him, and then the one after him? He's leaping on me, so defend. Oh, that was weak. With a grunt that shakes the plane, the Klattamen swings its club to you. Its club and stomps toward you. Determined to crack open your bones, you raise your sword to cover your body as he tries to push you back with his great hand. His stupid eyes follow your movements, not wanting to take a risk. Oh. Cut him. Boom. Taking a chance, you charge in, hoping to skewer the Klattamen on your blade. Swinging hard enough to cleave stone, you stab. He evades as well as he can. He staggers and groans. Enraged by your attack, he beats his club against his palm, readying himself. I'm gonna cut again. Good. Oh, wow. I took off 4 points from him right there. You strike again. You attack. The Klattamen is exposed, club raised, and cannot protect itself. But Klattamen's eyes are bloodshot, and he is moving much slower now. Unfortunately, we can only sideswipe. And we still win. You lunge forwards again, chasing the brute with a passing blow, wearing him down. Then your sword slips between the Klattamen's ribs, and he falls, gasping his last. Skilled swordplay. Continue. The third Klattamen hangs back, concern written all over his stupid face. He begins to back away, clutching the amulet around his neck as if for protection. I'm going to kill him. Sorry, he might come back with more friends, first of all. Second of all, a bit more of an evil reason, but it is one of two reasons I want that amulet. But if you let him escape, he may bring others back with him. Exactly. Cut. Boom. Giving a roar that shakes the plane, the Klattamen lifts its club and stomps toward you, determined to smash you to pieces. You try a fast lunge for his heart. He raises his club defensively, in time to stop your blow. He is left breathless, but otherwise unharmed. He beats his club against his palm, readying himself. I'm going to go for another cut. Oh, crap, he won that barely by 0.1 point. 0.1 points? You risk an attack, but it fails. The Klattamen raises its enormous club and brings it crashing down on you. You're caught off balance. You stagger to the ground, stunned by the blow. One more cut. Good. We're like evenly matched here with these attacks. Taking a chance, you charge in, hoping to skewer the Klattamen on your blade. Moving swiftly, you aim towards his heart as he swings for your head. He staggers and groans. His stupid eyes are watching you closely, not wanting to take a risk. I'm really low on energy, or attack power, as it were. I'm gonna try a side swipe. Hopefully it's his downtime. You know, they attack once or twice and then they have a downtime. No. It's still barely like even. You spy an opening but misjudge. The Klattamen sweeps for you with its club. Your own weak thrust is knocked aside. His stupid eyes are watching you closely, cautiously. Again? Last time I win. Stealing your courage, you charge in, punishing him with a worrying cut, wearing him down. The Klattamen parries slowly. The Klattamen stumbles suddenly. He is weakening. His eyes are watching you closely. Got that one. Boom. Boom, boom. You strike again. Grabbing a nearby stone, you throw it at the Klattamen's groin. Playing dirty. Then your sword slips between the Klattamen's ribs, and he falls, gasping his last. 3-5 stamina lost. Competent combat. Damn. You search the bodies quickly, but find nothing exciting. Only one has a couple of gold pieces and the spine of a rat, while another has a pouch containing a weight of sand, tied to the end of a stick. Perhaps a weapon of some kind. The third has an amulet. You pocket the gold immediately, but the rest seems worthless. I don't think the amulet is worthless. One has a couple of gold pieces. A pouch containing a weight of sand tied to the end of a stick. I guess it could be a weapon. Look at the amulet. The amulet is more interesting. At its heart is a shimmering stone, a jewel of gold. It's for me. You pry the jewel of gold out of the cheap clay setting of the amulet and put it in your sack. Take the rat spine. I was gonna let me take two. Let me take the sand pouch. You untie the sand pouch from the stick. Alright, take the rat spine. You pick up the rat spine. It is in good condition, strung through with a length of cord to stop it falling to pieces. Tie it into a loop. You tie the cord into a loop, making a neat bone bracelet. Bone bracelet, guys. We just found two more magic reagents or, you know, whatever, items. Making a neat bone bracelet which you slip onto your wrist. There is nothing more to be done. You leave the foul creatures to rot and move a short distance away to find a patch of ground. Good, I was wondering about that. Not soaked in blood. You pick up your gold piece once more, then you roll over and attempt to go back to sleep. The Priest's Pole, Day 5. During the past day you gained some gold, plus 2, entered the steps, and met Bria, the sorceress. You get to your feet. In the daylight, you can see the pole is made of wood and has clearly been cut from a pine or some other straight tree and then sanded to a smooth surface. It has no knots, handles, or holes of any kind, nothing except a level platform right at the top. Clumps of yellow moss, much like the one you tried earlier, grow around the base of the pole. Do I want this moss? You gather up a handful of moss. It is much like the last bunch you ate. Okay, you stow the moss in your pack, but it quickly dries and crumbles to so much dust. Okay, never mind. We don't need to eat right now, and I'm not sure if that's poison or not. Look around. You stop and look around, but can't make out much. Can't make much out across the contours of the plain. You might be able to stop to see more from the top of the pole, of course. From somewhere nearby, you hear singing. Okay, before I do anything, I'll take a look at these new items we got. So excited. Oh, wait, no descriptions. Pouch of sand. I know what that's for, actually. At least, it's for a spell. Bracelet of bone. And a jewel of gold. Alright. Let's just stop the loud music. Sand. Sand is for mud. The quicksand spell. Excellent. Jewel of gold is for, lesser. It says charm, but I put lesser in, parentheses. I'm not sure why. Looking for God spell. And it should be in yellow, because we have the items. There's the mud spell, quicksand. Spell is cast. Any creatures or humans nearby will take an immediate liking to the caster and will offer aid and information. This illusion spell can only be performed if the caster is wearing a jewel of gold. Okay, what's the other thing? A bone bracelet. Bracelet of bone. Kid. An illusion spell. Only works on intelligent creatures. Hope you guys could hear me with that music. I don't know why it's so freaking loud. Okay. So we have access to more spells now, which is excellent. Why would we bang on the pole? Let's just listen first. Start banging on poles. You concentrate and listen. There's definitely a voice somewhere close at hand, but there is no one anywhere in sight. The pole is set into a slight rise in the ground, and you can see in all directions. An invisible creature, perhaps? Again, questioning why I'm going to bang on the pole. Call out? Who's there? You demand. turning on the spot as you speak. Show yourself. A moment later, a shaggy face appears over the edge of the platform overhead.
Who's that? It demands crabbily.
Can't you hear I was doing the singing?
Apologize? The man shrugs.
For what?
Nice to have some company, even if it does get in the way.
He scratches his beard. A second or so later, a few lice shell husks rain down on you.
Ew!
From in his beard.
What are you doing up there?
The singing, he answers. I see you're dumb as well as deaf. Deaf and dumb, there's a pair.
To demonstrate this, he raises both hands and waves them.
I hope nothing comes out of your hands.
So, what kind of Definitely a voice. Yeah, it didn't say what kind of voice.
What can you see?
You ask.
The future and the past is one,
the mystic calls back to you, glancing from one waving hand to the other.
Join in and separating and ghosts walking back and forth. None of us are quite when we believe ourselves to be.
You bless your mind. What does it mean? The man spits. The spit takes a moment to hit the ground, so you have time to move aside. Lovely. But it appears the gesture was by way of a parable.
Just as everything falls, he says, so all past must the future create. That sort of thing.
He hasn't invited me up, so that's why I'm basically just talking to him still. I would like to learn more from you. You continue. The man does not reply, but leans away. However, a moment later, a hand appears over the side of the platform and something falls to earth. It is a medallion.
I'm taking it.
You take hold of the medallion. Nothing in particular happens.
Come on, then,
the man says, gesturing at you, and he disappears from view. Dust funnels across the empty plain. So he's up on top of the pole? There's something up there. Look at this medallion. You turn the medallion over in your hands. It is jewel-studded and set on a loose chain. It is probably worth something. So why did he give me this? What is it? I gotta see. Magic item. Jewel-studded medallion. Jewel-studded medallion. I just found a jewel of gold. Now we have a... Oh. We have a jewel-studded medallion. Oh, it's for the levitate spell. Zen. Float in the air as long as desired, may float around and will. That's great.
Cool. We have, like, so many magic things now. We actually have more spells. I mean, more gold. And, yeah. All we need is some food and our health restored.
climb the pole. Why not? Curious as to the platform, you attempt to scale the pole, but it is impossible. There is no grip at all. In fact, it has been lacquered to a polish precisely to prevent climbers. To the north, a thick forest rolls with mist. Why'd you mention...
I don't know why that last line was pretty random. So, yeah, I'm going to levitate.
Levitate. Zen. Obviously, that's why he gave us that. Hopefully, we can keep it.
Fastest spell ever cast.
Looking to the constellations overhead, you craft the spell and the medallion begins to glow as you rise gently up into the air. You are now floating off the ground. I have an opportunity to cast another spell? What would I cast now? I'm just curious. I'm not going to. See what... Oh, any number of things. I can cast it again. But it says I can do it as long as I want.
What's huff? Some kind of breeze spell, right? Oh, would that help propel me along? That'd be cool. Yeah, gust of wind. Oh, gale horn. I actually have that. I'm inexperienced with that, though, because I just want to go over to where that is. Sun light spell. Why would we need that? It's morning, isn't it? Or is it still night? I don't even know. Light spell? Is that what it is? I'm pretty sure it is. I thought it was on this first page, too. I guess not. Sun? Yeah, light. Sun jewel. And typically we can cast... technically we can cast that as well. Oh, big? Is this for big? It... Yeah. So I'm gonna be large and levitating? Does that even work? Dock? What's dock? Oh, heal disease. I don't need that. Yeah, I'm just gonna try to levitate over. Float to the top of the pillar. You float up to the top of the pillar. Boop. The man shuffles aside to allow you to bob down while taking back the jewel medallion. Give me that. So you are a sorcerer then, he declares. I thought so. I am. I want that medallion. And an adequate one at that, he adds. He gestures around with the platform. Welcome to my little Eerie. But why are you on this pole? You ask. High from the world, I can see diagonally downwards onto the world, he replies. I can see through the layers of curse that affect this land. This whole place is unraveled like a poorly woven shoe. Is he talking, like, more normally? He demonstrates with his hands, balling them one over the other. After a moment, he says, more simply, Right here, I can see. Do you know of the Seven Serpents? You demand. Demanding now. He nods. I see much from up here. I know of the winged beasts and their quest to devour you, grind your bones to dust, and then spit that dust into the cup of the King of Annaland. Oh, that's all. He pauses to scratch beneath his loincloth. Oh. Lovely. So, he asked, do you like it up here? The view is superb. How am I going to insult him? He shrugs. I do not see why a view can be superb. It's only looking, after all. As he speaks, you feel a weight gather about your shoulders as you settle down onto the platform. The spell is worn off. Ah, you have to give me back the amulet, don't you, to let me down. Where can I find the serpents? They are looking to find you, Annalander. Each is waiting for you. Some are hiding, some are not. One waits for you in the very depths of Lake Ilklala. He means to pick you off when you're at your weakest. He is underwater. He nods. If you must encounter him, I fear the only way would be to swim until he senses your tiredness. But that is a most foolish course. Can you tell me the serpent's weaknesses? I know two. He shakes his head. These are most secret, but some I think can be guessed at. Fire serpent, for instance, his weakness must be one of extinguishment. Water is too obvious, I think. I would try sand. From the forest to the north, the trees seem to part and a gigantic bird lifts into view. Its talons gleam in the sunlight. Is it going to take me? Grab the platform. You grab the platform below, more to stop yourself from falling off in surprise than anything else. That's not why I was doing it. The bird approaches and swoops low. The priest screams, then a moment later he is gone, and the bird is flapping gently away. You are alone. There's nothing on the platform, apart from a few stray spots of blood from where the winged creature's talons punctured the man's side, and the jeweled medallion. Okay, well, he was telling me about the serpents. Could that be the wizard sent this bird? Because apparently he's been up here in this long time, and then he just meets me, and this bird takes him away. pretty random, right? I don't think it's a coincidence. Take the medallion.
You take the medallion and sling it around your neck. If you're not mistaken, this probably explains how he got up the pole in the first place.
Cast a spell. I'm gonna take stamina hit if I jump off.
Whoa, okay.
So the great thing about these spells that require items, I mean, the downside is you need the item, but the upside is no stamina drain.
You turn the starlight into alignment around you, and the medallion begins to glow as you rise gently up into the air.
Sit on the pole?
You float down... Ooh, I gained stamina. Nice. You float down onto the pole's platform and cross your legs to contemplate the sun. A few meditative minutes go by, and you feel cleansed and well-rested. Time passes. A moment later, you feel a great weight settle about your shoulders. It is your body weight returning. Your spell has evaporated, and you are now stuck at the top of this gigantic pole. In the distance, a dark speck appears above the forest.
Is it another bird? Wait and watch.
I lost... Ah! The dark spot resolves into a bird-like shape and sweeps low, and a moment later you have been snatched up in the air by sharp talons. One new clue, another clue has been updated. We lost the stamina we just got back.
Oh! You're taking me there?
No! Alright, let me check my clues. I don't even know what happens now. The fire serpent is vulnerable to sand. I don't know what was updated. Probably this. Probably this, actually. It will wait until you're alone to try to pick you off.
Okay. Okay. We're going here. Carried away.
Great wings beat above you. You wriggle and struggle, but there is no safe way down. Below, the steps transform into thick, tangled forest.
Climb the creature?
Well, I'm kind of attached to the talons, aren't I?
Talk to the bird.
Let me go, you demand of the great bird, hoping it can perhaps understand the common tongue, even if it cannot speak. And indeed, perhaps it can. The talons begin to slide from your flesh, and you are about to fall.
Grab the feet.
You grab for the creature's feet, and it lashes back, kicking you sharply in the face. The talons retract, and you are tumbling downwards through the air towards the canopy.
Great.
And what? All the way over here? I'm falling horizontally. I didn't see that.
Whee! Don't look at my skirts.
You plunge to earth, the trees breaking your fall. Miraculously, you are largely unscathed by your ordeal. You pause as a thin, red-colored snake slides across your path.
Skewer it?
Could be rations, right? You draw your blade to skewer the snake, but it is too fast for you, twisting and turning to escape the blade and disappearing into the foliage.
I could make this a choice, but it's kind of a lame choice, isn't it?
Following it, it seems remarkably intelligent for a serpent. The snake reaches the foot of a tree and coils around the trunk.
Watch.
As you watch, the snake
slithers quickly up the trunk. A moment later, its head drops down from a branch to stare at you.
Hang back.
You hang back a moment. The snake waits.
I wait.
The snake coils around the branch on which it rests, seeming to grow in length.
Oh, what?
You hold your nerve watching. Something is definitely happening to the snake. It has grown tenfold in size, and two fiery wings are now folded across its back.
Now it has frickin' wings,
and is giant. Sly eyes watch your movements as if deciding its next attack.
You stare in shock and fear. The blaze of hissing fury must be the fire serpent.
Use an item. Oh, sand? You open your pack and look for something useful.
Grab a bag of sand.
If this is the fire serpent, then its weakness is sand. The creature watches you cautiously. To the sand.
Oh.
You toss the sand at the creature, but in the branch overhead it is too far away. The snake twists to one side, and the sand scatters to the ground, lost.
Great.
Doing something, climb the tree or do something, like what?
Oh.
You look about for a new approach, but you're out of time. The serpent drops from the tree, fangs bared.
Oh my.
I was gonna make this a choice, but I don't know what. It just said climb the tree or do something else, like what?
Oh my.
Crap. Flames surround the serpent as it launches itself towards you. You take two steps back and raise your guard. The serpent barrels forward, flying arrow-like through the air, only to crash against your defense. Fire licks the edges of the serpent's mouth.
It'll be another long episode, guys.
Oh, shh. Then the trees are alight with flame and the heat is unbearable. You try to swing, but the serpent's claws rake past your blade. Burns scour your skin like whip strokes. The creature coils its scaly body. Oh, I should have attacked now. The flames lapping around the creature draw sweat from your brow. You drop back as the serpent lashes out quickly with the tip of its tail. The creature's claws draw inwards.
Boom. I only have 3 points. This is not going to work.
The flames around the serpent seem to dull for a moment. You spin about, blade high above your head. The serpent is rearing back, but you catch it as it retreats. A line of fire streaks along the length of the serpent.
I'm going to defend.
That was a good choice. You take a step away as the serpent arcs forward. Quickly sidestepping, the creature smashes into the bushes behind, setting up a wall of sparks. The creature seems to flash with heat. Not sure if I should attack when it seems to flash with heat, but I won that one. For a moment, it seems like the creature is recovering its strength. You stride forward, committing all your weight to the blow. The serpent is rearing for you. You drive your blade into its open jaw. The serpent's fire flickers. The serpent's fire grows dull. I can only sideswipe, though. It didn't even attack. I should have sideswiped. You drop a short distance from the serpent. The fire serpent circles backwards. Heat rises from the creature's scales. Actually got that one. Every moment wasted is a risk, and you cannot risk a moment more. You risk another heavy cut. The serpent screams in rage as its own strike serves only to impale it on the blade. Fire creeps around the serpent's open jaws. So that bird brought me right to the fire serpent. And the other bird, I mean, it might have been the same bird, took the guy who was telling me about it. Fire creeps, and I got 1 point. You take a step back as the serpent lashes out with its fiery tail. You hold your position, deflecting the blow. The smell of seared flesh fills your nostrils. Your own. Snake eyes narrow and watch you. You step left, blade low and strong. The snake is clearly fearful, moving back, attempting only a minor attack. The flames around the creature flicker a deep, dark red. The creature retreats a little way into the trees. Side swipe it. Your only hope is to keep up the attack. You do not hold back. A quick stab cuts through the serpent's scales. The fire serpent rears back, escaping the worst of the blow. The creature flies up into the air, opening its jaws wide and baring teeth like daggers. I have to... Either way, it's going to take a point from me, at least. Yeah. Your sword glows white-hot in your palm, but the fire serpent's wings batter punishingly into you. The last thing you see are the serpent's long teeth coming in to pierce your eyes. Ow. Then the flames envelop you, and all goes bright, then dark. Do we begin with defend? I forget. Can I go... No, it doesn't show me. I'm gonna defend. Yeah, good choice. No matter how many points it does, it seems to only take one point from you when you defend. So now we want a strong... Oh, not strong enough. Damn it. Again? We're not doing well. So it... Two huge attacks at the beginning, at least... Yeah, we're not working this time. Flashing with heat. I'm trying. Stroke after stroke, you keep on at the serpent. You slice and dodge, avoiding the worst of the serpent's fiery grasp. Grasp. Yeah, goodbye, cruel wolf. Something comma? Try again. Alright, so... Alright, defending. And then... Defending. Now we're gonna cut. Good. We're gonna cut again. The claws draw inwards. All I have to do is really sideswipe, which is all I can do, which is fine. I'm gonna defend. It's flashing with heat. I want to cut. Damn it. Barely. It barely beat me there. Fire is dull. Narrowing. Ugh, beat me. Crap. Defend. I guess maybe I should take a blimberry juice. I can beat that second one if I attack. I remember seeing this. Quickly sidestepping, the creature smashes into the bushes behind, sending up a wall of sparks. I like that. Here, we're gonna cut. Cut. Claws try inwards. Side swipe. I should have defended. I'm gonna defend now. cut. Defend. Oh, I should have attacked. When it flies up into the air, I'm gonna defend again. Cut. Cut. Barely made it. We got it down to four, guys. The flames from the creature do not hold you back. You risk another heavy cut. The serpent is rearing for you. You drive your blade into its open jaw. The creature turns its fiery body. We can only sideswipe, so I'm going to defend. I might have been able to beat it, I'm not sure. You drop a short distance from the serpent. The serpent flicks a percussive blow, but you turn it easily aside. Yep. Talons curl into fist. Cut. A rapid slash bites into the serpent's hide. Short blue flames appear from between the creature's scales. Snake eyes narrow and watch you. Sideswipe it. Good. God damn. Even that. 8 stamina loss, but still competent combat. Maybe the toughest creature we've fought in this game. Is that panic you see in its eyes or murderous intent? You cut and move, slipping past the serpent's fiery breath. The fire serpent's eyes turn coal black, and it looks up at you, questioning, helpless, in the final second before it turns to a dark, dead husk. 1 stamina, guys. Whew! You step back, gasping with relief, sword heavy in your hand. Congratulations, you have defeated the first of the 7 serpents of Manpang. 6 left, guys. You feel a new spring in your step. 1 serpent has been defeated. Soon the rest will also fall. You move on through the trees. Alright, now I didn't want to leave it to a movement. I do want to finish looking at stuff here, so I'm going to move... head back, at least try to move back out southeast. I know this is an hour-long episode, sorry guys. You walk on between the trees. The mid-afternoon heat floods the valley. The trees loom about you, twisted and old. There were forests in the Shamutanti Hills, but nothing in comparison to this. The forest is ancient. The forest of Snata is ancient, and it is a maze. There are no roads to it, only twisted paths and dead end. Look like a road from the map. But who knows what secrets it may hide. The path looks wide and well used, but there are no signs of who or what uses it. Then, a little further along, you reach a spot where the trail is suddenly narrower, with bushes tight on either side. You know what? We might be doomed in this playthrough. I mean, I hope not, then I'll have to rewind, but... I want to see if we can make it with 1 stamina, but we can take a... At least we might be able to beat something minor with 4 points. Look at the bushes. You pause to look at the bush and see that its branches are twitching ever so slightly, curling and uncurling like reaching fingers. Yeah. Yeah. Alright, guys. Choice is here. Crap. 1 hour episode. I had no idea. Okay, should I draw my sword? It means I'm going to attack the branches. I'm guessing. Maybe. Or maybe I'm just going to draw my sword and cut through. They're probably going to attack me. Draw my sword, squeeze forwards to them, or turn back. I'm going to hack and slash my way through them and or fight them. I'm going to squeeze forwards and they might attack me or take some stamina from me, either one. Or we're going to turn back because I don't really have a lot of stamina points right now. So let me know, guys, what you think I should do. 1 of 3 choices. Draw my sword, squeeze forwards, turn back. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Thanks for voting, and Thanks for everything. Thanks for watching. And see you guys next week. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.